Good morning and welcome to Congregational Church of the Chimes. I am Pastor Curtis Peake. I'm the associate pastor here. And this is a new day, the first Sunday of spring. And I know everyone has had a great week because the gyms reopened. I saw people at the movie theaters last night. The vaccine is going around. They're saying every adult will be vaccinated by the end of May. And we are having an Easter sunrise service here, and we will open soon. So welcome to our church.
Please join me in the call to worship. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Do not cast me away from your presence.
And do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation.
Sustain in me a willing spirit, and let me praise your name. And now please join me in the invocation, followed by the Lord's Prayer.
We seek your presence with us, O God, that we might lay down our burdens, get rid of our sins, clear our minds, and find courage to be the persons we ought to be. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the living of our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught his disciples to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Happy spring. So I'm talking about a gap. A gap. An opening, a space, a break, a divide, a vent, a crack, an interlude, a breather, a slit, a slat, a slot. A gap has many names and actions. You can take a gap year in between high school and college, or during college just to get a handle on things. I had a gap between my two front teeth and needed braces to fix it. There are gaps between mountain ranges and gaps in between events, gaps in sidewalks, gaps between rocks where a waterfall might go through. In advertising marketing, we used to say there's a gap between a consumer need and a development of a product to fill that gap. GAP is text talk for gotta pick. In conversations, you might be asked to fill in a gap for more information. There can be a gap in continuity or a gap in consistency between one thing or another. Adjusting a spark plug in your car, that spark plug gap is really important, which I found out with my last car. There are gaps in time, then they're bridging the gap between things. There are gaps in performance, which is the difference between envisioned and actual performance. I heard a story this week that prompted me to think about gaps. A young boy's father had passed away when he was really young, and the boy was a hockey player on a really great team. And his dad would always lace up his hockey skates, and this was kind of their ritual, and it was a good luck thing for the game that was to come. When the dad passed away, the boy didn't have anybody to lace up his hockey skates. But the other dads on the team rallied together. Without any fanfare, making a big deal about it, The dads would rotate and just go over and quietly lace up the boy's skates. He made a promise, that boy, to pay that action forward and to fill in gaps in other people's lives. The reality is, COVID has, in fact, created gaps in our lives. And I have some ideas on how to fill a gap in the name of Jesus for someone or a group, to give someone a boost, to fill in an emotional gap, and to express thanks for who they are. Some of the ideas are support someone in a nursing home by writing an unexpected note to lift their spirits. It doesn't have to be anybody you know. Just call their nursing home, ask for somebody, or just make it generic and send a couple of notes. Make a couple of blessing bags and hand them out to people in need to fill that gap of a hungry stomach. Make someone's day a little brighter who is in the hospital and write a note to let them know that they're being prayed for healing. Write a note or draw a picture for a school teacher to let them know that they're appreciated. Make a call to someone here at the church who might be living alone and let them know that you're thinking of them and they're really not alone. Make cards for people in the church or for the worship team here just to let them know that you treasure them in your hearts. All of these ideas fill a gap with Jesus' love. And I'm going to go out on a limb here and suggest that Jesus fills gaps in all of our lives every day, and we just don't understand it or just don't see it or hear it. He fills the gap in our souls and hearts from our hectic and topsy-turvy life. Every day, the hustle and the bustle. But what our really souls need is that Jesus to fill that gap. My advice, for what it's worth, is to dream big, do big, and fill that gap with Jesus. Will you pray with me now, please? Dear God, we know there are 1,000 ways to fill the gaps in our lives. There are practical ways to fill the gaps and openings, and then there are more important ways to fill them. Filling in our faith gap is so very essential and very, very needed. Help us, God, to bring the imagination and determination and strength into us to reach out to you and your Son, Jesus, to fill our brains, our souls, and our hearts with all that you have, all that you have presented to us. Trusting you to direct us to fill our faith gaps with kindness, grace, and love, to dream big, do big, and be big in filling as many gaps as we can for ourselves and others. In your name we pray, we say, amen.
Good morning, everybody. As we enter Eastertide, we're gonna do a little bit of, we're gonna do a carol this morning. Believe it or not, there are Easter carols. This one actually has a melody of a Christmas carol, but with Easter lyrics to it. It's Now the Green Blade Riseth, hymn number 210.
Now the green blade riseth from the buried grain. Weep that in the dark earth many days have lain. Love lives again that with the dead has been. Love is come again like weed that springeth green. In the grave they laid him, love who had been slain, thinking that he never would awake again. Laid in the earth like grain that sleeps unseen, love is come again like wheat that springeth green. Forth he came at Easter like the risen grain, Jesus who for 3 days in the grave had lain. Quick from the dead, my risen Lord is seen. Love is come again like wheat that springeth green. When our hearts are wintry, grieving or in pain, Jesus' touch can call us back to life again. Fields of our hearts that dead and bare have been, love is come again like wheat that springeth green.
time of prayer. And as we center our hearts with God, we pray for Marlene Zucker, who is having her surgery on Tuesday, in our prayer for successful surgery and a diminishing of her pain. We pray for Rita McKenzie. We pray for John Sullivan and his family. John's father passed away this week. Let us pray. We gather here in thankfulness as we come together in these moments of prayer, knowing that you hear the words of our hearts and the secrets of our souls. Draw us close to you, Lord, that we may be reassured by your presence and cleansed by your grace. Let the covenant you have written upon our hearts direct us every moment of every day. Then as we continue our journey with Jesus during this Lenten season, be with us along the way. Strengthen us when we feel too weary to face the challenges of our world, the bitter and scorching hatred that erupts so often into violence, the suffering from famine and disease, the economic struggles which make everyday life hard to sustain. And soften our own hearts, that we see and accept all of your children as our brothers and sisters, loved, respected, and protected. And we offer our thanks, Lord, our thanks for the light which is beginning to shine, thanks for the minds and the skilled hands which are slowing the virus. Keep us vigilant that we may conquer it. And Lord, we are so grateful for all the blessings in our own lives, for family and friends, for the beauty of your creation, for the life and love which renews us, which refreshes us in our faithful commitment to you. And this morning, Lord, once again, our hearts are breaking from those who have suffered the hands of hateful violence. We offer our prayers for the families who were shot in Georgia, Soon Chung Park, Hyun Yoon Grant, Soon Cha Kim, Young A Yu, Delana Ashley Yon, Paul Andre Michaels, Zhao Ye Tan, and Dai Wu Fang. And Lord, we ask too, as we gather in this fellowship of love, that you will make Marlene calm as she anticipates her surgery, which might be successful and will diminish her pain. Be with Diane Delaney's parents as they continue Carol's strengthening, and be with Rita McKenzie in these days. We surround John Sullivan and his family as they mourn John's father's death. We know he rests in peace in your comforting embrace, and may our prayers comfort the ones who loved him so much. God be with each of us and all of us as we journey together to the cross and then to the empty tomb. In the name of your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
This morning, I ask you to join us today at 1 o'clock for our racial justice Zoom call. With all that is going on in the world, especially what just happened in Georgia, please join us. The Zoom link is in your Friday e-blast. So please join us today at 1 o'clock for racial justice. You cannot beat God's giving. No matter how hard you try, the more you give, the more he gives to you. As I sit here this morning and look at our beautiful sanctuary, I would like to thank everyone for your continued giving during this pandemic and your estimate of giving. Continue to give, know that we love you and we appreciate you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for everyone that gave, Heavenly Father, and we ask that you bless the ones that wanted to give and did not have it to give. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
The scripture lesson this morning is from the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah, who's considered a major prophet, whose book is actually the longest in the Bible. But it was at a critical time in the history of Israel and the Jewish people. He wrote these words when many of the Jews were in exile in Babylon, and he wrote these words of comfort, reassuring them that God was with them always. So listen to these verses from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah, verses 31 to 34. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenants which I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it upon their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each man teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive them their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. May these sacred words guide us and direct us and be received in our hearts. Amen.
We covenant with our Lord and with one another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according to he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. Are you holding on to a covenant? Are you holding on to that covenant? That covenant comes from 1629 from Salem. And this is our covenant here at Congregational Church of the Chimes, even still today in 2021. You see, a covenant is a two-way promise between God and man. God sets the terms, but we keep our part of it. God will always keep his part. Now, they have been a part of God's relationship with mankind from the earliest days. The Old Testament is filled with stories of covenants of God made with his people. And the results that came about when people chose to obey the covenant or disobey the covenant. You see, making covenants is a sacred experience. It must never be made lightly. And it should not be made for a reward. Covenants are a sign that you love God and that you want to obey him and that you trust him, even when it comes to making hard decisions in your life. You see, making a covenant with no thought of a reward, knowing that the reward may even come not until the next lifetime, to have a sincere act to God of love and faith. After all, when you love someone on earth, you make a covenant with them. You get married. And in fact, right before the service, I hope Greg don't mind me telling this story, but he told a beautiful story that made all of us laugh. He posted on his Facebook page that marriage is like asking each other, what do you want for dinner, until God calls you home. So as he was getting ready this morning, Chris came into the kitchen. He said, what do you want for dinner? He said, oh, maybe we'll have pork chops or something. So they made a covenant. So a marriage is a covenant. See, if you are in a marriage or you are in a covenant with someone, you are willing to change your life and make sacrifices for that person. Your willingness to do this for God should be even greater. Now, we've all heard the stories about a man crying out to God and promising him something in exchange for pulling him out of a predicament, pulling him out of a situation. That story has come familiar to all of us. You see, the promise he makes could be a material sacrifice, or he can say, God, if you get me out of this, I'm going to mend my bad ways. You see, God, being trustworthy, will answer those prayers. See, this story is familiar because this story we all know. This story is our own. At some point, we encountered problems so big that we felt helpless and did not know where to go. Now, I can tell you a little story about my life. I'm sure a lot of you guys can relate. You're in college and you're out in your fraternity or your sorority and you're partying and you might have a little too much to drink. And you go home and you hug the toilet and you say, God, if you get me out of this, I'll never drink again. And what happened? The next day you start drinking again. You broke that covenant. You see, a covenant should not be taken lightly. So we turned to God and made a covenant with him that if our prayers are answered, we will serve him or give up a prized possession to his church or any other promise that we feel would help us move our way. You see, a covenant by definition is an agreement or a contract between two parties that contain conditions, duties, and obligations that should be fulfilled. In this case, God helped and blessed us by answering our prayers. Now the question is, did we keep our end of the bargain? Only you can answer that if you have made a covenant with God. Are you keeping your end of the bargain? See, let me tell you something about covenants. They can never be broken. As Dr. Bingham read in the scripture this morning, Jeremiah 31, God is saying, I'm not breaking this covenant. He said, I will make a new covenant. It's a new covenant. It's added on to the covenant, a better covenant. You see, a covenant can never be broken, only replaced with a better one. My friend, God will do as he has promised you. We have to trust. And he will set your heart at ease. He bound himself to a covenant with you when he cut it with your representative. And our representative was Jesus when he died at Calvary. So rest easy in the knowledge that you have a covenant-keeping God who cannot break it, who will not break it. You see, his covenant or renege, he cannot break his covenant or renege on his promises. Simply lean on his faithfulness. And like Abraham, you will walk in your inheritance and you will walk in your healing. For me recently, some life experiences got me thinking about the personal covenants that we make with God, not covenants that are part of the standard ordinance of the church like the sacrament or baptism, but other promises we make personally to God. Have you made a personal covenant to God? Often we face circumstances of severe trial or unusual distress. We reach out to God and ask for special blessings and a promise. If we get those promises, we get those, then we will say that we will do certain things for God in return. Now, while these covenants differ from those made of the standard gospel ordinance, I have come to believe that they carry just as much weight, they carry such power and a potential for blessings from God, perhaps even more so. You see, the scriptures have several examples of these non-standardized personal covenants that individuals or groups of people have made with God. You look at Hannah in the Old Testament. She is an example that stands out to me. I can also recall stories from other living prophets and apostles and other prominent leaders where they discuss making personal covenants with God. In the book of Abram, it teaches that God sent all people to earth to see if they will do all things whatsoever the Lord their God shall command them to do. And only you can answer that for yourself. Are you doing what you feel God wants you to do? Or are you every day trying to negotiate with God on the covenants that he's given us so you can just make it through? See, I have often thought that another related purpose of this life is for God to see if we would do two things that we promised that we are going to do. If we will do the things that we covenant to do, whether it be a standard covenant through the traditional gospel ordinance or a personal covenant we make with God. This morning, what is your covenant? What covenant have you made with God that you've broken? What covenant have you made with God that you are keeping? See, God wants us in a covenant relationship with Him. He will be our God, and we will be His people. See, our relationship with God is not one-sided. A covenant is only legal if it is an agreement made by both parties. God is calling us. God is calling us into the covenant. We bind ourselves with our Lord. You see, Moses tells us, "The Lord our God did not make this covenant with your fathers, but with all of us." All of you who are here and alive today, the problem that we have today is that all churches tend to live in the past. No longer mourn for the past. It shall never come again. See, we are surrounded by ceremonies, rituals, and traditions until traditions actually become more important to biblical authority. That just blows everything out of the water. We are so living in the past. You see, God has given each one of us a personal covenant. And what is yours? Our Father God says, "I did not just make this covenant with your fathers." See, I'm not here on earth because of my father. I'm here because of God. I'm here this morning because of God. God is not a man. He cannot lie. When my father died, when I was 14 years old, and my mother came into my room and saved me from the fire that was in our house. And I remember as I grew up, I prayed to God for healing. I prayed to God for a healing of my family. And then I read Jeremiah 29:11, and I got an answer. God says that He has a plan for me. And after I read that, that has been part of my life, and that's a covenant I want to have with God, and I will do whatever I can to have that covenant with God, because if God has a plan for me, I'm going to take that plan, and I'm going to obey that plan. See, I prayed a prayer of deep desperation, and God not only heard me at my prayer, He gave me a future. When I could not see a future, God gave me a future. See, I know that God has made a personal covenant with me, and that He is now in the process of opening doors for me so that I may accomplish all His work which He wishes for me to do in the future. What covenant have you made with God? You see, making a covenant with God and you know you can't keep it, then don't make that covenant with God. Don't go out there and try to con God and say, "God, if you get me through this, I will never do it again. God, if you heal me, Heavenly Father, I promise you I'll be at church next week." God heals you, God does whatever He says He's going to do, and you don't show up. You've broken that covenant. You see, when we act rashly, we are doing things foolishly. The best way we can do things in life right now, we need to pause, we need to pray, and then we proceed, rather than recklessly making a promise or making a covenant to God. If you can't make that covenant to God, just pray to God. Say, "God, be here for me. God, lead me, and God, guide me." You see, none of us here today, we don't know the future. We often resort to making deals and promises and covenant with God out of uncertainty and fear because we do not know what the future holds. This is exactly why we do not need to make those covenants if we know we are not going to keep them. See, since we do not know the future, we also do not know if we will be able to keep or maintain those vows, those covenants that we are making. We are fallen and prone to misjudgments. We do not know what tomorrow holds for any of us. I often think back to the promises that I made in my young years of following the Lord and how I had failed to keep them because I did not realize what the future was going to bring for me. But when I realized that I want to be in contact with God, I wanted God to hold me in the palm of his hands, I try to keep every covenant that God has. And if I make a covenant or vow to God, I will do my best to go to God and say, God, thank you for being in this covenant with me. You see, if we believe his words and we stand upon his truth, then we do not need to make promises or vows. We need only to trust him. Don't make the promise, don't make the vow, don't make the covenant if you can't keep it. Just trust God. Give your life to God. We need to only trust when he says he will make all things work together for good. He will make all things work together for good. This means trusting him. This means trusting God. Even if things get a little scary and a little difficult at times, God is in control, not us. God is in control, not us. You see, when we react rashly and try to con God into doing what we think is best by making a promise or a vow or covenant, then that doesn't work. You have to just trust God and lean on his everlasting love for his children. See, I don't think it is wise to make a vow or covenant to the Lord or anyone. Just simply say your yes is a yes or your no is a no. If you have made a vow, if you have made a covenant, I would say by all means, do your best to uphold it. Do your best to make it happen. Do your best to uphold it. Or if you feel like you're unable to, take it to the Lord and confess your inability to keep it because you made it recklessly. You wanted something on the other end. And if you make one and break it, or if you have broken it, it is not unforgivable. Confess your failings. Confess and move forward. The Lord knows your heart. And one of the greatest things about living under this new covenant is grace in Jesus Christ. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. No condemnation. This morning as I leave, I want to leave you with this. But most of all, my brothers and sisters, never take an oath by heaven or earth or anything else. Just say a simple yes or no so that you will not sin and be condemned. James 5:12. You see, the enemy, they will try to trap you into your words against the Father. Be wise with your words and don't worry about making promises to God. Just trust God. I believe with spiritual maturity will come more and more ease of trusting God to take care of you. You see, God never breaks his covenant. We covenant with our Lord and with one another and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. That's a covenant here at Congregational Church of the Chimes that we make with each other. We covenant with our Lord and with one another. God bless you. Amen.
My heart is filled with thankfulness to you who bore my pain, who plumbed the depths of my deepest grief. who reigns above, whose wisdom is my perfect peace, whose every thought is love.
As I close this morning, as I close my 10 at 10s every Tuesday and Thursdays, I pray for you, you pray for me, and God holds us in the palm of his hands. Have a great week. This is a new day. Things are looking up. God bless you. Amen.
Go now in peace, never be. Thank you.